folks, you probably know me from various other places. The two names on the slide here, that's Mark and me, we're only a very small part of a very large team. Unfortunately, the leader of the team couldn't be with us today because his wife's sick, but I want to give a short video of him plus the clarinet operating before we start, just to set the scene. Mark, over to you. Is there any way we can dim the front lights?
The Artemis Orchestral Competition is an annual competition held in Europe for machines to play unmodified musical instruments. The purpose of the competition is to display the usefulness of small computer systems, otherwise known as embedded systems, in performing a complex task, in this case playing a musical instrument. We won the competition because the clarinet is a difficult instrument to play. To build a machine to play the clarinet displayed a degree of innovation that impressed the jury, particularly in the design of the mouthpiece, where we had to control the air pressure going into the clarinet and force on the reed.
That was John talking. He's the leader. But the Artemisia, which is where all this started, is a consortium of mostly European research organisations, universities and manufacturers, whose aim is to encourage embedded systems research and development in Europe, mostly, and Australia. To do this, every year they have a number of challenges with cash prizes at the end of them. One of those challenges is the Artemis Orchestra Challenge. The aim of this one is to try and play an unmodified musical instrument. Theoretically, a human player who can play the instrument could pull it out of the robot, put it in their mouths and play it. In practice, in order to maintain mechanical stability, the thing's bolted down really hard, and you probably need a chisel or something to get rid of the Loctite. The instrument should play arbitrary tunes really well. The organisers provide a series of Lillipon source files and on an FTP server that's accessible via 802.11b. The robot needs to be able to fetch all of the files that are in a particular directory that it knows about via FTP across the wireless link, and then it's supposed to present a little menu of some sort so you can select which one to play. It then compiles the Lillipon source or does whatever it needs to develop what it plays from, and then should blink a light when it's ready, and then you push the button it's supposed to play. That's what's supposed to happen. We only had 6 months to do this, so it was a kind of crash program. John, when he started doing this, went across to the musical acoustics lab, the physical acoustics lab at UNSW, and met up with a fellow called Joe Wolf, who's a keen musician and physicist and runs the lab. And after discussing it a lot, they decided on the clarinet as the musical instrument to play. There's good reasons for this. Unlike, say, the saxophone or a brass instrument or an oboe or something, embouchure is not quite so important. And in particular, the vocal tracts, the part of the mouth behind the lips and tongue, don't affect the acoustics of the instrument very much unless you're someone like Acca Bilt playing Rhapsody in Blue. So you can't do real good jazz effects with the robot, but you can play most classical pieces. So you can play a bit, well, Brahms is difficult, but you can play some Carnegie von Weber or some Mozart or something like that, or Flight of the Bumblebees we just heard. Well, the competition was in early June 2008, and we won. Woo! Yeah, you hold the microphone for me. What I want to show you is some of the things that John said were difficult. This is a clarinet mouthpiece. I'll just take the ligature off. There it is. You can see through it, right? Just like that. You might notice that surface there is curved, which means that when you bolt the reed on it, which I shall do here, another little factor, real reeds, need to be wet to work, otherwise they don't have the right springiness. When you bolt it on, they're also very fragile. When you bolt it on, there's a little gap, the tip opening. Now, theoretically, you should just be able to take that and blow down it. This is what happens. not a lot. In principle, the harder you blow, the louder the note. And the softer you blow, the softer the note. But without reducing that tip opening a bit, by providing a bit of reed pressure, you don't get any sound. So let's try it with a bit of reed pressure. I'm just going to use my teeth to move the reed up a bit. That doesn't sound very musical either. The reason for that is you also need a bit of damping. And if I do it that way, it's very close to top C sharp. And if it were actually coupled into the clarinet, you'd be right. You might have noticed that the beginning and ends of those notes were very ragged. That's because I didn't use my tongue, which is the other bit. A clarinetist uses his tongue to close off that tip opening entirely and stop the reed at the beginning and end of each distinct note. If you've got notes that are supposed to be slurred together, he won't do that. He'll only tongue the first in the whole series. Sometimes, for some notes, like the really high ones, it's really hard to set the reed vibrating. So you just need to flick the tip of the reed with your tongue. And if you've got downward leaps by a 12th, which is just the difference between the upper register and the lower register, if you just release the register key, the speaker key, it'll carry on speaking at that top note. So you generally just need to touch the reed with your tongue to stop it vibrating at the top mode and start it in the lower mode. A good clarinet player will be able to do that and you won't notice. Robot? He's an okay clarinet player. Okay. I'm now going to hand over to Mark to describe the actual clarinet stuff itself.
Okay. First, I want to show you a photo of the completely assembled system so you can get a feel for what's there and how all the bits connect together, and then we'll go through it in more detail. So what you can see is the clarinet, and that sits in a Perspex cylinder. Connected rigidly to the Perspex cylinder are a bunch of brass plungers, and they point inwards towards the clarinet and they act as the fingers. This thing here is our simulated mouth. You can see airflow coming in from the left, and there's a bit of a pressure release valve there, and that's all maintained with a PID loop. You also notice that it is filled with white stuff. What that is acoustic baffling foam, and we use that because the resonance we want is going in the clarinet. If we have a resonance here, that will usually sound terrible and be a squeak. So we're trying to attenuate high frequencies by putting some foam in there. Controlling all the mechanical stuff are three PCBs here that we purpose-built for controlling this robot. They contain some things like power electronics for solenoids and some analog stuff for interfacing sensors, like an air pressure sensor for the PID loop. To the very left, falling off the edge of the picture, are a little GumSticks and RoboSticks computer. If any of you went to the Arduino talk, the RoboSticks is very similar to an Arduino, and a GumSticks is a little computer running Linux. Okay, so all of that stuff in more detail. This is our mouthpiece when it's outside its airtight chamber. So air would be coming in from the left. And remembering that we need air pressure, the tongue, and damping and pressure onto the lip. This is how we've tried to come up with that robotically. What we've got is a big red servo which acts as the lip. So we have a servo and a couple of levers, and then that right there is a block of sorbethane. Sorbethane is a rubber material that's designed to mimic the properties of human flesh, and a real clarinetist will use their lip to control the damping. So hopefully that should simulate it appropriately. But we also found we needed a little pillow of acoustic foam to get the dampening properties that we really need for it to run. This was the hard bit, and it's really why we won the competition. There was an entry from Team Dare, which is a group of Dutch robotics enthusiasts. They produced a guitar entry, and it really sounded fantastic, but the guitar is very easy to play. So the technical difficulty of this, and since our quality was comparable musically, that was enough to tip us into the lead. Okay, so that is the lip. Air is coming in from the left. This is another little servo motor, and it's a bit fuzzy, but that thing, if that were to turn counterclockwise, it would stop the end of the reed and act as our tongue. Yeah, so that's the really hard bit done. This is another projection showing more of the levers. What a servo motor actually, yeah? Wetting the reed. The reed, yeah. Traditionally a wood reed, as you see here, requires moisture, but we used a plastic reed as it doesn't. This gives you a better picture of how we're trying to convert from the position, which is what a servo motor tries to maintain, into a predictable force onto the reed there. And you can see a little blue servo, which is the tongue. Okay. Now what we've got is a very simple system, right? We've got one axis of pressure going onto the reed, and that's about it. But what a real clarinetist does when they're playing is vary how their mouth works depending on what note they're trying to play. For instance, for a very high note, they're likely to bite into more of the mouthpiece. So effectively, they apply pressure more about there than there. So depending on what note you're trying to hit, and whether you're trying to play it sweetly or loudly or softly, they'll do a different thing with their mouth. And we don't fully understand how they do that, but what we're trying to do is develop a new mouth that can take some of this into account. So this is a new mouthpiece, which you should hopefully be able to see at open day. What it has is a kind of C-shaped thing like this, with hooks at either side. So if you pull on one hook, it will apply more pressure here. If you pull on the other hook, it'll apply more pressure there. So we can hopefully simulate the characteristic of clarinetists of using more or less of the mouthpiece depending on what note they want to hit. Okay. So that pretty much concludes the mouthpiece. Fingering, you would think, is a fair bit easier because really all you have to do is press down, press up. It's very, there are only two states and how hard can it be, right? No, it was very difficult and you need to maintain an appropriate air seal. If you stuff the air seal up on a note close to the mouth, all of the ones beyond it are effectively useless because you've got a resonant note under the one that's slightly open. So how we're doing it is to have a series of brass plungers. They're again rigidly mounted to the cylinder and they point inwards. Inside each one of these is a spring. So the spring inside pushes down the finger to simulate us pressing our finger in. Connected via a brake cable goes down to a bank of solenoids. The bank of solenoids pull on the brake cable, which pulls the plunger, which releases the key. So we use the plungers. Sorry, we use the solenoids to release and the plungers to press. Okay, that's about it for the mechanical side of things. Are there any questions so far? Not quite. Oh, yeah. We've got a video showing the fingering. VLC play V2. Yeah, tab. So onto the software side of things, Artemisia is an embedded systems consortium, so obviously they really want to see an embedded system solution to this. So what we've got is a gumsticks and a robosticks. I said a robosticks is vaguely similar to an Arduino. The gumsticks is a little memory form factor computer which has an ARM-based PXA processor. So that's running at 600 megahertz, and this guy runs Linux. The Gumsticks build system, which is open embedded, comes with the Angstrom distribution of Linux, and that comes with a bunch of kernel patches and things appropriate for making it run the Gumsticks. So we've got that there. Also, Peter mentioned that we have to run Lilypond. Lilypond requires basically half the world in order to run, so we needed to install Debian Lenny just to get all the packages required to run Linux. And the Gumsticks has a micro SD card, so we can put that much stuff on it. Okay. The software is basically broken up into three parts. We've got some pre-processing here on the Gumsticks, and that runs as user programs. What that has to do is take the Lilypon file that we get from the judges and convert it into a plan, which is every fingering, every air pressure event that we're going to do in the song. And each one of those events has a time next to it. So here, after pre-processing, we know everything and when we want to do it. The event scheduler is a Linux device driver, which it takes all of those packets and then starts sending them out in real time. So on this diagram, the GumSticks is actually a MIDI master device. That sends out MIDI packets timed appropriately, and we can plug this into a keyboard or something and have it actually play. The RoboSticks and beyond act as a MIDI slave device, so they'll listen to stuff from the GumSticks, like play a C and play it this loud, and convert that into, okay, a C means I need this fingering, I need to put the servo motors wherever, up to there. Put the servo motors wherever, set an appropriate air pressure, and hopefully the note will come out. This is GumSticks. On the left, it's got a little LCD screen, 4.3-inch thing. It's got wireless LAN in order for retrieving FTP files and stuff. That is goes off towards a USB keyboard, so it's actually a reasonably useful self-contained system. That's the RoboSticks, and this is a little line-level converter. Okay, so in more detail, what does the pre-processing need to do? Once we've got the plan from, once we retrieve a Lilypon file, that is basically all the music we need to play. So what extra detail do we need to put in there? If you play a piece of music exactly as it is written, it usually sounds fairly dry, but there are also things that clarinetists know they need to do in order to play properly. Peter mentioned large descending intervals, like if you go from a really high note to a really low note, then you need to add a tongue. Otherwise, it will just keep playing the high note because there's a resonance within the clarinet that doesn't collapse properly. As well as that, we have latencies in the system. So if you ask for an air pressure, that won't just change instantly. It's related to how big the mouthpiece chamber is, how much air is going in, how much air is coming out, and how well we can control that. We also have a latency associated with the fingering, so there are springs and things that need to move, and that takes a finite amount of time, which is probably going to be different. So what we try to do is take all of these latencies into account, so when we actually play a note, they all line up, and then it sounds good. And after that, we need to just deliver the events to the device driver. This is a sort of block diagram of what the device driver is. It uses the hardware timers on the GumSticks processor in order to schedule events. How accurate does this need to be? Like if I just click out a rhythm, it slowed down at the end. But how accurate does it need to be before you know that I slowed down? It turns out that that's about 4 milliseconds, so that's a complete upper bound on how good this is allowed to be. It has to be better than 4 milliseconds, otherwise it's guaranteed to sound out of time. We run a million interrupts through this and counted the latency of each one using the timer interrupt registers, and we found that the worst case latency in a million interrupts, which is about 700 songs, was 161 microseconds. So this is way better than we need and way better than random error introduced by the mechanical hardware. The average case was within 10 microseconds. Okay, so this sends off MIDI events towards the RoboSticks. What the RoboSticks needs to do is listen to these events, decode the MIDI, and then use various lookup tables to figure out, okay, if I need to play a C, this is the fingering I need to do. Then it sends out SPI towards a bunch of H bridges which control the solenoids. So given a particular note, it goes, this note is associated with this fingering, bang, send that through the solenoids go chunk, and then you've got the new note. The RoboSticks also uses a PID loop to try and maintain the appropriate pressure within the mouthpiece chamber. So that's pretty much it for what happens in the software. We only had 6 months to do this, which is fairly time constrained, but here are some of the things that we'd like to try and do to make it better. At the moment, we've got a completely ballistic system. So we set a fingering, set an air pressure, set some angles in the servo motors, and think, OK, we calibrated this. Hopefully, that will make the right note throughout the performance. What would be really nice to do is use pitch detection to figure out what note it's actually playing. If it's playing a squeak, try and do something about it. It will sound terrible, and that you don't know how long that note's going to be. So if you're squeaking, reduce the pressure or apply the tongue or something, so that should make it much more pleasant for the audience. If we have pitch detection, we should be able to make it calibrate itself. It could experiment with pressure levels and servo parameters and figure out which ones make it stay in tune with consistent volume and nice timbre and stuff like that, and figure all that stuff out by itself, and then use the same mapping in reverse to actually deliver the performance. Director Musicas, and that is spelt correctly, it's a piece of software developed by KTH University in Utrecht. What that does is apply a set of rules to music, and what those rules do is create perceived emotion. So by using these rules, we can send it through a bunch of filters and go alter the stream slightly in a way that makes the music sound sad. This is what robotic instruments and a lot of music is criticized for, that it doesn't sound emotional enough. There are kind of well-defined tricks, if you will, that we can use to try and add emotion or try and make it play in a way that we perceive as emotional. And that should really enhance the quality of the performance for the audience. Okay, now I'll hand you over to Peter, who will talk about the lily pond work that he did for this.
Yep. Are you ready to play the music? Yep. Okay, just wait for... Lily pond is a purely a typesetting program for music. How many people can read music, by the way? Oh, quite a lot of you. Good. Well, there's a few things here I want to point out that... Okay, Lily pond has a MIDI output, but it doesn't obey most of the musical things that you might want to obey. For example, up here we have phrasing marks, slurs, trills, turns, tenuto, rallentando, a tempo, and dynamics. Of those, the only thing that Lily pond understands are explicit metronome marks and dynamics. Which means that when you take a piece of music like this and generate MIDI using Lily pond, it sounds like this. Most clarinet music looks something like this. This particular piece starts about bar 4 of Karl Maria von Weber's Theme and Variations. What it should be doing, of course, is firstly, all notes that aren't under a slur or phrasing mark should be shortened a little bit. Any note that's marked with a staccato symbol, that's that little dot up there, should be shortened a lot. In fact, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, in his True Art of Keyboard Playing, said that when you play a note that's marked staccato... Sorry, I can't do a German accent. When you play a note that's marked staccato, you should play it as if the keys are hot, too hot to touch. So you touch it and it goes... So, in modern playing, you generally shorten staccato note to about half its written value. So, what we want to be able to do is to shorten all the notes that are on their own, not marked staccato or legato or anything like that. We want to play any notes marked tenuto, that's with the bar over the top, at their full value. And those trills and turns and grace notes and things, we want to expand them to do the right thing. And we also want to have some idea of how much to slow down when we get to a rallentando. In fact, it should sound something like this. Now that sounds much more musical, doesn't it? Okay, great. Lily pond has an extension language. It's Go. That's really good because I'm a Lisp. I'm an Emacs hacker, right? And Emacs has Lisp as its extension language. Go's just Scheme, which is a sort of Lisp. So I should be right, right? No. It's an extension language, which means that it's got all these extra primitives that are part of the Lily pond internals. So you need to understand how Liddy-Pond represents music and how to manipulate that to get the right thing. What's more, there's been a grand documentation project that Liddy-Pond's been running, and they didn't actually write the bits for this bit until a few weeks ago. So it was kind of interesting, shall we say. And it's, Liddy-Pond itself is huge and complex. I don't want to denigrate any C++ programmers out there, but I find large C++ programs, if you haven't got the design in your head and all the design patterns that it's using in your head, almost impossible to read, because you just follow this thing and you just work out, okay, that's inherited from there, which is inherited from there, but where's the code that actually does the work? That's C++ as far as I'm concerned. So it took 2 or 3 weeks to write the extension that basically rewrote that bit like this. So what we've done is we've replaced each crotchet with a quaver followed by a quaver rest. Sorry, I didn't mean to do that. We've expanded the trill. You'll notice I use the baroque trill, which starts on the upper note. We've incorporated the term at the end, those two grace notes, if we go back one. Oh, sorry, that way. Let me go here. There's a term there that's even though it looks like it's part of that note, it's actually meant to be tacked onto the end of that note. And you have to know that somehow. Anyway, we've incorporated that there. We've expanded the turn, and we've put an explicit tempo there instead of the vowel. And this is, I've managed to package this up really nicely. Basically, you do an include at the top of the Liddy-Pond file that you want to generate the MIDI for, and then a backslash articulate in the score section, which actually says has all the music. And it worked, and the judges were happy. So I'm happy. As I said before, this is not a single-person project or just a two-person project. These are all the people that are involved. The John there is holding the check for €5,000 that we won. So that's really good stuff. And that's the clarinet in the front. And if you're here on open day, you'll be able to see the clarinet in operation in live, assuming the courier hasn't stuffed up. And Mark's a real good Python hacker and kernel hacker, and he might be looking for a job soon. So if you've got a job available, go for it. Just to play out, we're going to play you one more musical piece. After we came back from Athens, we asked a lady in the music department, who's a really good clarinetist, to put on a concert with the robot clarinet as a duet. Just leave that playing in the background while we take questions.
An awful lot of time ago, I think it's around about 1991 or thereabouts, I was involved in writing a demo for Wait for It Sco Unix. We had 4 computers running, and I think we played, well, doesn't matter what we played, but it was pretty classical music. And I had exactly the same problem, but this was intended for the computer to read the speech as well, so that at least we didn't have that problem of the parabolics and so the dynamics really. I know exactly what you're saying about that time problem. It sounds dry if you use the music exactly as it is, and yes, you have to expand the trills and have to manually. We had an algorithm to link all 4 computers, and effectively, was good enough to synchronise them at least to the bar, and the ear couldn't detect it. We couldn't synchronise it any better than that. So yes, it has been done before, but not as elegantly as this.
In response to that, the Artemis Challenge has actually got 3 levels, and we only entered the lowest one. The lowest one is a solo instrument playing on its own, so it can't keep time with anybody. The second level has to follow a conductor. So, but we thought that the problems of doing video tracking and getting a good time signal out of a human waiting on a wander out, and actually getting the timing right for that. Because although Mark said it's 4 milliseconds, a good drummer can hear within heart within about 1 millisecond. So it's difficult. And the third level of the challenge is to get multiple robots from different families to go to the concert, all playing together, all following the conductor. Which is harder. Okay, another question over here, I think.
What was the reason?
A saxophone has a much broader reed and is reliant more on changes in embouchure and more on the vocal cavity and what you've got to do to get the different registers. You make a lot more changes in your tongue position and in your palate position when you're playing a saxophone. Clarinet is much simpler to work with. Yeah. Up the back there.
We're not really doing squeak detection quite yet. It's something we're developing, but one idea is to use a Goetzel algorithm, which is a Goetzel algorithm. It's like an FFT, but targeted at a particular frequency. So if you do that, or a couple of them at a few windows near a squeak, and we know what the frequency is of the note we're trying to play, if we listen for both of them and there's much greater intensity at the squeak, then, yeah, I guess that's how we detect it. Yep.
The Lilipon changes have been released as public domain source, well, it's GPL source, GPL version 2, and are on the Lilipon mailing list, and I've been updating them and sending them out every now and then.
But I mean, specifically for the event,
was
that like
a number
of bands you guys had?
No, I released them, and I've been talking with the people on the Lilipon list for several weeks before the event. That being so, I think we were the only one who actually used it. No.
I think it's awesome, and it's like, yeah.
Was there another question up the back there? Or you just... No, okay. Any more questions? Yep.
Have you used any machine learning sort of techniques for teaching how to play more like human?
For the moment, what we want to do is the rule-based interpretation, because that's firstly a fair bit simpler, and there's already been a lot of work put into that. No, we haven't quite considered using machine learning yet to try and figure this stuff out. There's a fair bit of literature on it, but it's not really what we're trying to do, since there's a package to create the effect that we're trying to create the effect we're trying to achieve.
Actually, the main use for this robot instrument is to work out how to play the clarinet both well and badly, in order to help music teachers teach their students better. Because at the moment, you get some effect that some student does and you've got no idea how to reproduce it or what they're actually doing wrong. I mean, you know what they're supposed to be doing right, but you don't know what they're doing wrong. And it's hopes that we can teach this robot to play badly in ways like a beginner clarinetist. And then we can say, ah, that's what you're doing. Yeah. In the middle there? That was out of scope for the competition. It's something we've been thinking about. Our aim is to be able to play Rhapsody in Blue. And for that, you play a very, very gradual, well, it's a subchromatic scale from the very lowest note of the clarinet to the very highest note to start with. It's like, whoa! Yeah.
Add to that? Yeah. How we're trying to try and accomplish something like that is, usually you would press harder in order to achieve that effect. If we've got the new mouthpiece, we can try and press harder and also alter the position of where it happens throughout the slur. And yeah, that's one thing we're trying to be able, we will be trying to quantify. Yeah.
You already have one. Is anybody else before you?
Okay. How many different ways to try to drive the buttons and the buttons? Does it work pretty well in the tables or
Yeah, we had a fair bit of experimentation with this. One thing we were going to try doing is to put servo motors for each finger. This has a couple of advantages, like we've only got discretized things, and if we can alter it and half cover a hole, we can get continuous slurs and stuff like that. We found this to be more rapid after trying both. But you probably notice a bit of a problem where it makes a big clicking sound. The Dutch entry had a pneumatic system, and that was remarkably quiet and very quick and worked very well. So given time again, or if there's going to be effort spent on redeveloping the fingering, we might try pneumatics. But that'd be nice. A nice fleshy pad at the very end would be good, because then you can cover it reliably. Oh, we can do infinite notes.
One interesting thing that was something we didn't realise when we first started was that you can see that great big plastic tube that was around the outside. It's a resonant chamber, right? So resonances in that chamber are actually killing some of the resonances of the notes. So when we first started, you couldn't play some notes, which is why the current version has got great big holes cut in it. Yeah. Okay, another question over there.
Have you thought of instrumenting a real clarinet so you can sense what a human player is doing?
The School of Music Acoustics is doing a lot of stuff like that. They've done some research using acoustic impedance to see what's going on inside the vocal tract of a real saxophonist when they're doing that sort of stuff. And that's one of the ways we knew to avoid a saxophone, because they're doing really exotic stuff with their vocal tract. We're doing a couple of other experiments, like putting an optical sensor just under the reed to see how fast it's actually oscillating and things. That's not particularly a target of this device, but yeah, we are looking into it.
If you look on the University of South Wales physics site, there's an animated clarinet on there with sound samples from real players for each fingering, including the polyphonics and multiphonics that you can do. And there's a big description of the whole thing.
Yep. Up the back there?
The competition that you mentioned, that's held each year as a different theme each year?
It's not necessarily a different theme. Yes, it's held annually. They decided to relax a lot of the rules after this year. A lot of the teams had problems dealing with early pond. Like, we had some excellent development on it, but I don't think this is going to happen next year. They're also probably going to scrap the conductor, because that wasn't executed particularly well by any team. So next year, it's... the rules aren't set in stone, but it looks like it's going to be much more of a free-for-all, where you've got rules with... it has to be an unmodified instrument, but then just, you know, show us what cool stuff you can do.
Did you extend the range of the instrument?
To get extremely high notes on the clarinet, you start needing to do exotic stuff with the vocal tract, like saxophonists have to do. So, in effect, we can get about 3 octaves. The top octave sounds horrible and squawky anyway, so I don't know why we'd want to go any further up, but...
With ring pressure and less ring pressure, were you able to get lower?
No, you can't get lower than the most fundamental resonance, and that's set by the length of the instrument. Yep. So up the back there.
Have you got any ideas for how you do quieter fingering?
Quieter fingering? Yeah, the pneumatics, as used by the Dutch team. Their guitar had virtually silent fingering. You couldn't hear any pneumatic noise or anything, and it was sufficiently fast for them, so yeah, that could be good. You might have noticed that the bank of solenoids is isolated from the rest of the instrument. We try to put acoustic baffling on that bank to suppress some of the noise, but we can't get all of it.
Essentially either off or on, aren't
Yes, we. Yeah, we experimented with using a servo motor for each key so that you did have continuous control over the position of it and you could get quarter tones and stuff like that. But yeah, for this iteration of the robot, it was just easiest to have a fast, clunky solenoid. Yeah.
Which wasn't very good.
Servos. Potentially, that's probably very highly funded research that they're doing there. There have been a lot of robotic instrument players that work by being anthropomorphic, and I guess that's more what their bias is. But we're making it very, very specific to the clarinet. First of all, because that's cheaper and easier to do and more likely to get a high quality result, but it's not general. So, possibly maybe in the future.
Okay, Jill, last question.
That would be fun to do. That works a lot better. Sorry?
Question.
Okay, the question was that some musicians use, they'll place something over the end of the clarinet or the end of whatever instrument in order to produce a particular effect. This is much more common in brass instruments as opposed to woodwinds. If you put your hand in front of it, if you wanted to try this at the demonstration, it really doesn't do too much except make it flat. Usually brass instruments, because there isn't... there aren't holes at the side of most brass instruments, they get a there's much more difference in the airflow going out of the instrument in total created by doing that sort of thing, as opposed to a woodwind instrument where there are many holes for like resonance going out. Yeah, it would be quite fun to put a couple of servos on the end and a mute or something like that.
And if we ever do a recorder, we'll have to, because that's the only way to get Topsy sharp.
Okay, I think we're done for that. So.
Thanks so much.